Jesus, take your place. Amen. Take your place. Somebody say, take your place. Take your place in my life. In all the other names, take it away. In all the other names, take it away. Amen. Amen. We are excited to be here today. God is an awesome and great God. Anybody excited about being in the house of the Lord? We should always be excited about being in the house of the Lord. Amen. I'm blessed to say our family is super supportive. Particularly for Lester Hicks and Barbara and Aaron Hicks and the rest of the Hicks family, because even after the funeral, you know, you still need prayer to kind of get through and get over it, amen? So continue to keep them listening to prayer for me as well. I'd like to know that none of y'all have known him, but a co-worker of mine, I just tried, he was going through a lot of health issues, and he's not been to work because of the health issues. Several strokes and also heart attacks. And so I want to keep my program of birthday lifted up first for his healing. Yeah. Amen. But just on my way here, I got a text saying that his son, William, has passed. His son is 28 in his 20s. And I met the young man and talked with him. He comes up to the job and, you know, drunk man. Couple times, just seeing that today, knowing that his father's already health condition that he didn't have to deal with his son and kind of tragedy like that. We just don't know. Amen. We just don't know. Amen. So I want to keep Berkeley ready and his family with me in prayer as well. We don't know when you're going to get the call and it's someone close to you. We don't know when God's coming. One thing we can be sure of, if we know Jesus, we go into a better place. Amen. Now is the time to know the Lord. How many more funerals are we going to have? How close to home is going to have to get before we all take a real good look at our lives and say, where am I in my walk with God? Not perfect, but where am I in my walk as having a relationship with Him? Have I fully committed my life to God? Have I really accepted Him in my heart as my Lord and Savior? Time is running out, and it ain't waiting on nobody. It ain't waiting on kids to graduate high school anymore. It's not waiting on you to find a husband, find a wife, get the nice house, the nice car, and the money in the bank. Time ain't waiting anymore. And we are having it. God has to, in His wisdom, since the world is so caught up and infatuated with people of the world, the sign even came when everyone got the news on last Sunday that COVID brain had passed. It's like the world stopped. I was in a church service and I got it on my phone and I looked down at it and when I looked up around the church I was at, I seen heads going down and all I seen was heads going down. And everybody at one time was getting it. Everybody was getting it where I was. Just looking at the phone, looking at each other, looking at each other, and having the phone. And it's like the world stopped because COVID brain died. And not even 2 minutes later, the world stopped once again, but it found out his daughter was with him. And if I don't know what else is going to wake them all up to realize that just because you're here today, that don't mean you're going to be here later on. Come on, somebody. We don't wait till the point. We don't got no church that we got get things on tomorrow. You be here today, going today. How are you loving the people that you have got in your life? How are you loving your circle? How are you loving your family? Are you separated? Are there any unforgiveness going on? It's too late when the casket is right there to say I'm sorry. It don't take but a minute to pick up the phone. It don't take but a minute to go over to somebody's house. It don't take but a minute to get somebody that we're wrong. Life is too short to be holding grudges and having these little temper tantrums. pronouns over nothing. And the main thing is life is coming to an end swiftly, and it's time that we make decisions on the next life. It's no longer I'm gonna hold up and get some more pocket, and I'm gonna hold up and do my thing a little more. I'm gonna get saved, but just not today. Those days are long gone, because I remember when my grandmother used to tell me Jesus soon returned, and I was probably about four. And I was like, when he ain't got back yet, by the time I got 15, I said, well, he ain't back yet, I'm gonna go ahead and get the party and then hopefully I get it all out before he comes back. But and so we've been told he's coming, and because he hasn't just magically appeared yet, or he hasn't cracked this guy yet, we think that we got time. But if you follow it along with the word of God, you'll find out that his return is sooner than we think. You'll find out now that he is soon returned. He is coming back sooner than we all think. And I would suggest on today that we look at our lives really good, really close. Think about Kobe Bryant, remember him for how great he was, but remember no way, no matter how much he had, no matter how much equipment he had, no matter how professional the plane, the helicopter pilot was, that none of that could save him when it was his time. I know he bought the best helicopter because he had the much money to buy the best of everything, but billions of dollars didn't save him. Billions of dollars didn't stop what was going to happen. And I'm here to tell you today that when it's my time or when it's your time, you best believe, I don't care how much Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Medicare you got. When it's your time, it's your time. But the question is, are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Amen. So we're looking at the word today because God has given us a great word, a new series we're starting in the month of February. As we are entering the year of 2020, he gave us a theme for the entire year, the goodness of God's grace, of God's goodness and grace, the year of God's goodness and grace. And don't you know that goodness is God's best? And grace means that it's the favor of God, and it's unmerited, it's unearned. So what God is saying is, in the year of 2020, I'm going to give you my best, even though you don't deserve it. Come on, somebody. God said, I'm going to give you my best this year, even though you don't deserve it. And being a recipient of the blessing, we can miss out on God's goodness and grace because of a few things. And last month, God called us on giving God your best. When you give God your best, in return, God will give you what? His best. We learned that from Abraham walking. He promised Abraham that he would make him the father of many nations. And, I mean, he really showed Abraham some great things, but Abraham got away from the Lord. to report correctly that God requires that you can't live any kind of way and expect God to just bless God, because God don't bless mess. God will not bless mess. And we have to bring it back to the truth, and we have to teach the truth, because the truth is what sets us free. So on the day God is saying, I still am good. This is still my year of God's goodness and grace. I know we've seen some things happen in the news that don't look like it, but we don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. And in today's reading, it's found in Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 38 through 42. Our new series is called Removing Distractions. Come on, somebody. Can I teach you before I preach it? But I want you to get it. Removing distractions. As we stand for the reading of God's word, I want you to just meditate on just this series alone. And that should move you to want to not just be here on Sundays. You want to get this. You want to be back on Thursday night, because it is not enough time in the day to really dwell into it like we want to. So we invite you to come back on Thursday to get the breakdown of the first message in the series of the month of February. We call Removing Distractions. Luke 10, verse 38, then it reads, now it happened that they went. He entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted. She was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me. And Jesus answered and said to Martha, Martha, Martha. Can I tell you right now, when Jesus called your name twice, you're in trouble. You ever had to call your child name twice? Boy, your mama had to call you twice. When she said your name two times, that means something wrong. In our modern day time, when your mama called your poor name, see, back then, they didn't really dwell on the last name. They just called that first name. When they call that first name twice, that means you in trouble. But in our time, when she said Kevin Jones, I said, oh boy, I said, that's a whoop. You know, that's a whoop when your mama's name gets called. And so we know this is not serious, because he said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part, which would not be taken away from her. Second verse is found in verse 40, but Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, Lord, do you not care if my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you now asking that you just have your way in our midst. Holy Spirit, lead and guide the servants. Speak the wisdom of God. Speak the very mind and thought of God into each of our hearts. That the seed of the word will be planted in our hearts, come out of our life and make a difference that glorify the Father. Father, we take no credit for anything, because we can do nothing without you. So right now I need you to move in me, mind me. And I only speak to those that are under the sound of my voice, but speak to me, Lord. Speak to me, Lord. I need the word from you on today as well. And Father, we'll be so careful to give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. It's in Jesus' right name we ask and believe and receive. And those that know the Lord say amen. Amen. As you take a seat, the series is called Removing Distractions. Sermon number one is called The Danger of Being Distracted. Come on, somebody. See, we're going to break it down again, and we're going to take our time with you. We're not going to be teaching for our preachers, because I want you to really understand that there is a danger in being distracted. So instead of just bombarding with a lot of what to do and everybody getting rid of, we first better recognize how dangerous it is. Sometimes we take lightly what a thing is, and then it could distracted with what serving. Even though she had the same opportunity to sit at the feet of Jesus and hear the word, she allowed herself to become distracted with what serving. Understand, I said she allowed. See, sometimes we allow things into our lives that's not good for us. And then we blame the devil for it. Can I say that again? Sometimes we allow things into our lives. Then when those things that we allow in our lives turn out not to be good for us, we blame the devil. But sometimes you got to hold up that mirror and look in that mirror and say, you did this.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen. Sometimes you got to look in your own mirror and look at the person that's looking back at you and say, you did this. Some days the enemy gets blamed for he has nothing to do with. Some days that we attributed or credited to him, we're making him more famous than he really is. Sometimes that enemy is the enemy within me. Sometimes I'm my enemy because of what I allow into my life. If you allow it, that means you accept it, you tolerate it, you condone it. And then when it's found out it's not conducive or good or productive, he says, it's a devil. But on the day we're going to shift that. Because the enemy, he don't mind having dirt thrown on his name.
Right.
He don't mind me giving him credit for something that he ain't doing. Reason why? Because if you're confused enough to believe that it's him, then you won't ever come to your senses and get it right.
Amen.
But on today, we're going to straighten that up now and just hold my mirror up and say, some of the stuff that you're going through, you allow it. Talk to me. Some of the stuff I'm going through, I allow it. Before we go any further, though, I want us to be clear that Martha wasn't a bad person. She wasn't a bad person. And it wasn't sinful for her to want to clean her house and prepare food for Jesus and his entourage. That's just all hospitality. So she was a woman, and they grew up in a culture where entertaining guests was something really important to them. They grew up in a culture where when you came to their house, they made you feel welcome. They rolled out the red carpet for you. They cooked for you. They made sure their house was clean. They made you feel welcome when you got there. See, we don't got away from that. Have you ever went to somebody's house and you felt like you wasn't welcome? You ever went to somebody's house and they didn't bother to clean that up? They just look at you and they sit down anyway. You got to come up with something quick. So you have to try to say, well, you know, I'm going to stand up all day. I'm going to sit down all day. You may not want to sit down. But if you're tired, buddy, you find a way to say, you know what, I've been at work all day, I ain't sitting on that. Who that out of the way, man? They don't make you feel as well. Let's go public. Sometimes you come into God's house and you don't feel well. Sometimes you can come into God's house and the people of God over the house, they don't make you feel well. So we understand that she come from a culture where that was normal to do. However, because Martha became so consumed, that's the key word, she became so consumed with serving that it distracted her from what was most important, hearing the Lord. Notice, distracted means you are unable to concentrate because your mind is preoccupied. Distracted means you are unable to concentrate because your mind is preoccupied. Let us say again, distracted means you are unable to concentrate, and most of the time you're unable to concentrate on what's important because your mind is preoccupied with so much other stuff that is not. Somebody I'm talking to, the Holy Spirit is talking to me. Because sometimes you can be so preoccupied in your mind with stuff that is important to you, but it's not important to him. And you become so concentrated, so occupied with what you are thinking about that you are not concentrating on the things you should be doing. Sometimes we complicate our life because our minds are so occupied. It's so busy. It's always thinking and moving and running. It's always creating and trying to figure stuff out. Preoccupied. Distracted. You can be in church and be distracted. Because that's one of the ways the enemy works. He has your mind thinking about what you got to do when you get home. Who you got to go back home to? Who you came here with? What's going on here? Who you don't like here? What you got to do when you get to work Monday? You ain't promised to make it work. Or how I'm going to get a job? You might not need one. How I'm going to pay this bill? What my kids doing? What my wife doing? What my girlfriend doing? What my boyfriend doing? What my husband doing? Distracted from hearing God. Came to get a word. Jesus showed up at your house. The one that got all power. The one that can solve any problem. The one that there's nothing too hard or impossible shows up. And you're distracted. You did what you need. That's when you can come to church buttered down, bothered, discouraged, upset, and leave out burdened, bothered, frustrated, and upset. You don't ever supposed to come into a house of the Lord where he's present at and leave the same way. It ain't something wrong with God, it's something wrong with you. And that's because you're distracted. Sometimes we get distracted by the smallest thing. What somebody got on? What did he get their hair cut? Did he get their hair done? Did you see what she wear? Did you see what he had on? Distracted. Distractions. We should be getting the word. Listen to this. Martha had so much going on in her mind that she couldn't concentrate. She didn't stay focused. She didn't stay focused. Tell somebody, focus life. Somebody say, focus life. People ask me, say, man, why don't you come to this place? Why don't we see you that place? I said, my life is focused. I'm living a focused life. I have no time for distractions. I wouldn't be where I'm at now if I concentrated on the things of where I came from. I have to stay focused. You gotta stay focused. You can't drive for it looking back. I don't care how good you drive. You can't drive like this. You can't drive like this. You need to stay focused. She couldn't stay focused because her mind was just so preoccupied with doing. Note this. Gotta note this. Whenever you get to a point where you are unable to concentrate because your mind has become so preoccupied, it's easy to start operating in your feelings and start doing and saying things under the influence of them. I will. Whenever you get to a point where you are unable to concentrate because your mind has become so preoccupied, it's easy to start operating in your feelings and start saying and doing things under the influence. You start making decisions in your feelings. You start saying stuff out of your feelings. And then there's a danger in being distracted. Because listen to this. Martha made 3 notable mistakes because she was distracted. 3 notable mistakes were made by Martha because she was distracted. She was unable to concentrate because she was preoccupied. She had a busy mind. 1, by being distracted, Martha deprived herself of taking full advantage of Jesus being in her house. She made the first mistake by being distracted. She failed to take advantage of being in the presence of the Lord. You can get so distracted that you fail to enjoy and take advantage of being in the presence of the Lord. Why do the enemy want to keep you out of God's presence so bad, even in church? He wants you to believe that just because you came, you're okay. But coming and getting that from that leads what? I ain't the best mathematician, but 0 from 0 leads what? See, I ain't graduated from all kinds of high colleges, and I don't have all the matriculation through a lot of educational institutions, but my mom did taught me how to count. She wasn't a smart mom, but she said, well, whatever leads you, you will learn to count. And I know how to count. And I know 0 from 0 always believe 0. I don't care how the world twists. You will never be able to twist that. See, the world can't twist numbers. They can twist all kinds of statements, all other kinds of stuff, but they cannot twist numbers. 0 from 0 gonna be 0. You come and get nothing, you will leave with what?
Nothing.
She made a fatal mistake because her mind was so preoccupied, and now she's operating in her feelings, and she started saying new things under the influence of her feelings. She made the first mistake of depriving herself of being, or taking full advantage of being in God's presence. Why? Because in the presence of the Lord is the fullness of joy, and in his right hand is blessings forevermore. When I get in the presence of God, I got peace with God. I don't care what's going on in my life, you can't get my peace when I'm in his presence. And then when I'm in his presence, you'll get in his right hand on the blessing forevermore. That means whatever I have need of, I'm in the presence of the one who can meet that need. See, that's why the enemy will keep you from getting to the presence of the Lord, because he knows you'll get that need met. He want to keep you begging. He want to keep you bothered. He want to keep you up against him. He want to keep your hand and mouth paycheck. He wants you like that. But if you ever just slow your mind down and enter into the presence of God, you'll have a peace that when the storm comes, you can sleep in the storm. People be wondering, why you ain't going crazy? You're going through the same thing we're going through, but why you not acting all that good at? Because I got the peace of God, because I'm in the presence of God, and I know that he's going to bring me out of there. Number 2. She's so preoccupied that she can't concentrate because she's not that distracted, that she made the second notable mistake. She accused Jesus of not caring about what she was doing for him by herself. You can get so distracted, so preoccupied with trying to figure it out, work it out, how it's going to turn out, so busy in your mind that you make that second vital mistake. And you look at your circumstances, you look at what you've heard now, and you come out your mouth to the Lord and say, you must be on here. And you take the Bible and you throw it down. And say, I don't believe you or him. I ain't come to church no more. I ain't praying no more because I'm going through it. And God ain't hear me. And God was real. The Bible was real. And God was trying to say this. Why is this for the God right now? Why is this praying the Bible? God of not caring. Be careful. Be careful. Because you say, okay, I tell you what then, how about I just remove you? If I don't care. I care enough to bring you home. See, some of us right at the point, and we may not know it, you about one more I don't care, yourself. What are you talking about? I don't care. You don't think I didn't care about you? You think he would have hung up there? But we didn't get distracted. She was a good one. Because she went on to hang with him and he had a relationship with her. It was like she was bad. She was just what? Distracted. It ain't like she was sinful and she was out there in the street. She was just what? She was distracted. She was just distracted. Some of us, man, we are not bad people. We don't really mean no harm. We are just what?
Distracted.
We're just distracted. But the danger of being distracted can cause you to do and say things that are hurtful and offensive. Notice how Jesus, how he responded to her questions and accusations. Verse 41, he said, Martha, Martha. When he called her name twice, he wanted her full undivided attention. There was no more sweet Jesus. It was the sternness of God speaking to her. This was the God who sent his son, who wrapped himself in flesh. He's speaking now. He said, Martha, Martha. Meaning, hold up. You're about to go too far. You're about to cross over a line that you don't want to cross. You're about to mix me up with people. Just because you can disrespect some people and get away with it. You got a track record for how to kill people. He said, you in the wrong person's face to accuse of anything. And I want to say this on the day. We have to be careful not to get so distracted that we think that we can approach God like we approach people. Gotta be more careful. Look at your mirror and say, I know what I'm going through. So don't try to run up on God like you can run up on him. Because you think what you're going through is rough. It can get way worse if he takes hand off you. He said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things. See how you check it? He said, you don't want to worry about it.
Yeah,
I got that. He said, Martha, Martha, you are the only one stressing this. You are the only one tripping out about this. You are the only one that lip poke out about this. I ain't tripping. I came in. I'm good. Yeah, you ain't got to go through all this. You don't take all that. You're the only one that's making a big deal out of this. You worry for nothing. You don't got distracted for what?
Nothing.
He said, in other words, you got too much going on in your mind, and you are overthinking this thing. You're overthinking. Sometimes, and this goes on in the Christian circle a lot. Sometimes we try to be too deep. You're overthinking Christianity when you think you have to be so deep. There ain't how many hallelujahs and how much bumping and all that you can do. That don't solidify whether you saved or not. It's how you live your life. We overthink some things. And she was overthinking. He said, Martha, you are going too much. You're going too much. Verse 42. He said, but a few things are needed. Indeed, only one. He said, Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Here's a biblical life lesson. Here's a biblical life lesson. He said, Martha, you are worried for nothing. He said, now, you don't brought in Mary who had nothing to do with this. So let me give you something about that. Let me tell you about her. He says, there are only a few things that are needed. All of what you're doing is unnecessary. He said, really, the only thing you need is one. He said, Mary has chosen. You know what you like? And what you choose.
Right.
Yeah. You allow foolishness in your life, it will get foolishness. You choose not to allow foolishness in your life, it won't come.
That's right.
to serve who? Jesus. All Martha wanted to do was what? Serve Jesus. Guess what? Mary wanted to be taught how to serve Jesus. Y'all got that, or you'll get ahead of the park, right? Did it get you right across the track? Oh, I got it. Martha wanted to serve Jesus. But Mary wanted to be taught how to serve Jesus. There's a difference. I'm going to give you a point of observation you lead with. Learn how to do it before you do it. Learn how to do it before you do it. Too many people want to serve, but they don't know how to serve him. Learn how to do it before you do it. Because if she would have sat beside Jesus like Mary did, she would have found out Jesus wasn't even concerned with that the flow of your copper wasn't back. If she would have took time to sit and listen to Jesus, she would have learned that serving him don't come from trying to impress him. Impressing God don't work. Serving him do. But before you can serve him, you got to learn how to. If you can't come and try to tell him how you want to serve him. You got to learn what he wants, and then you then in return join in when he's at work at. Because you will find out that a lot of times what you want ain't what he wants. How you try to approach him is not how he want to be approached. He just let him teach you first. That's why you tell him Martha was Martha. You ain't had to do all this. You ain't had to wash your dishes. You ain't had to wash your clothes. You ain't had to go in there and throw out some food. You ain't had to go and go to the grocery store and try to buy a whole bunch of food. I know how to turn two dishes and two loaves into another. You ain't had to go do nothing. You ain't had to put macaroni, ham, hot dogs. You ain't had to get all that stuff. She all in the freezer, you pulling out everything because she's trying to serve him, but she really don't know how. Trying to do too much. And we can do this in the church. Do this for the church and church leaders. You can try to serve God too much, trying to do too much. You can try to take all these positions, but God said, that ain't where I want you at. Learn how to serve me before you try to do it. Learn what I want yourself to be. Before you just jump out there thinking that this impresses me. Because it really don't. And then what is going to happen, it's going to occupy your and you're going to become what? You're going to become distracted. I know this ain't a book no more, but this is one that you needed to know. Martha was serving all wrong. She got caught up in trying to serve Jesus. I'm saying this. And I did have to wait. She got so caught up in trying to serve Jesus that she missed an opportunity to learn how. Can I say that again? She got so caught up in trying to serve Jesus that she missed her opportunity to learn how. What's got you so distracted that you're missing your opportunity to know Jesus? What can this world throw at you that is so important that Jesus and knowing him takes a back seat? What's so important? Is the job? I gotta work. Gotta take care of my family. Know it. The Bible says if a man don't work, man don't eat. Know it. But when the effort that comes before you having a relationship with the Lord, then that's a problem. Then that's a problem. Because then you try to think in your mind how are you going to work it out, figure it out, and start getting occupied. Your mind starts to work and see your mind ain't meant to be stretched to that capacity. Your mind ain't meant to have so much stuff going on in it at one time that you can't concentrate. You are going to overstep your bounds. When you find yourself confused, stop. You find yourself confused in life is starting now not to say you're so busy serving that you're not spending time with me. Is that you, Lord, today? Have you got focused on the affairs of this world that you haven't took and full advantage of the opportunity just to be in the presence of the Lord, just to wake up in the morning and just open your eyes and say, Lord, I thank you. Or hit the jump off, put the clothes on, and out the door. Trying to pray on your way to work. Lord, I pray I have a good day, pray no matter what the man, no matter pray, I don't have to tell him, I don't see nobody else, and get in there, I pray I ain't right here. I have to be going every day, man, so I pray for that day. But now I've heard that the best part of it is, just get up in the morning and just say, Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Lord God. I know it's tough to, but I just don't want to talk about my bill. I don't want to talk about the job. I don't want to talk about people. God, I just want to say thank you. You've been good to me. 49 years of living, God, you've been good to me. And I just want to say thank you, Lord God. It takes a real person to admit that and say, I'm going to have to strike. I ain't taking full advantage of being in the presence of God. And it's an honor to be in His presence. Don't you know the people out here right now, if you walk out this door, there's people all in this community, all walking up and down the street, on your way home, you're going to pass people who don't have your opportunity. They're so far.